Good evening from our headquarters in Kyiv. This is the Sunday show on Hromadske International, and we will look at the recent events of the last week and explain why they're important, what they mean.
Tonight we'll be looking at President Poroshenko's meeting with President Putin in Milan last Friday. We'll also be taking a closer look at the ceasefire and how it will continue in Ukraine's volatile east. And finally, we'll be taking a look forward to Ukraine's parliamentary elections on October 26th.
In our first program of the Hromadske project in English,
German Chancellor Angela Merkel went from moderate to more harsher her position on Russia and Ukraine in these debates.
Now, one of the key issues we were looking at while this was going on was gas, because while the talks were going on, there seemed to be hope from the side of President Poroshenko that there would be a deal, or at least a basis for a deal, allowing Ukraine to resume imports of Russian gas. As you can see from infographics we'll put up, Ukraine is very reliant on Russian gas for its heating, about 72%. So that has been a priority as winter is approaching. Now, for Russia, the issue has been with the falling price of crude. Energy is key, but this also affects the European Union, with many European countries reliant on Russian gas for their own heating purposes. And with those countries that have engaged what's called as reverse flow, supplying Ukraine with gas that Russia originally exported, having their supplies cut by Russia. Very nice to have you here, Mr. Klimkin. We're very excited to speak with you. The first question I had is, there seemed to be hope, you know, when there is still the Normandy format, when the European leaders were there meeting with President Poroshenko, that even if an agreement couldn't be reached in terms of the East and monitoring a ceasefire, that something could be agreed on with gas. And then when President Poroshenko and President Putin met alone, that seemed to disappear. Did that seem genuine, or do things change when European leaders aren't there in the room?
Look, firstly, it's not about a sort of balance between ceasefire and the whole situation around Donetsk, Lugansk, and gas. Firstly, the critical point also for Milan was the situation, really Donbass, sustainable ceasefire. Critical point about the border, about setting up effective control, because what is getting in Ukraine is getting from Russia. Into Ukraine, and it's all about mercenaries, about money, about weapons, about heavy weaponry.
So were ways to monitor that discussed? Were there concrete measures?
Yeah, exactly.
That were on the
and
table?
The idea now to progress, to go on practical technical ideas, technical means, about more drones. And we are talking now about a sort of special pool, including our drones, including German drones, including French drones.
But did Russia play a role in that process? Were they part of the discussion? Did they
facilitate? Yeah, actually, I understand that Russia now is contemplating the idea is to provide its own drones mm-hmm. for this exercise. So we need to engage them, but engage, of course, under the umbrella of the OSCE. Mm-hmm. And next week, starting from tomorrow, we will discuss how it could be organized.
And is that an idea Ukraine is open to, using Russian drones to monitor the ceasefire in the east?
It's not about us using Russian drones. It's mm-hmm. about OSCE using any sort of technical means mm-hmm. how to monitor and verify the situation on the ground in Donetsk and Lugansk, but also along the border. And it should be purely under the umbrella of the OSCE. Mm-hmm. It's the only precondition how it could be delivered. But it's also about video surveillance, about checkpoints, about spot inspections, about every kind of means which should be used for closing down the border. Mm-hmm.
But looking at Milan, is it, I mean, a lot of people have called it a failure because there is no concrete agreement that came out of it, not concerning gas and not concerning the ceasefire. I mean, how do you see that? How do you see the results of those talks?
You know, to expect a real breakthrough from Milan would be absolutely foolish, and I'll tell you why. Mm-hmm. Because it's not, you know, every other day that we meet Putin three times a day, and actually it was the special format. I would call it extended Normandy format, mm-hmm. also with David Cameron, also with Matteo Renzi, also with two presidents from the European Union. It was a real Normandy format, and it was a bilateral meeting. Mm-hmm. So a lot of issues discussed. It was a difficult chat, of course. But talking to each other on this issue in this format is extremely important.
But to be following that, you know, this ceasefire had been broken for, and it was told about like more than 1,000 times with different kind of using of weaponry. There is amount of the civilians died. And if you go on the ground, if you're on the ground, the people there tell it's a joke, the ceasefire. And it hasn't moved. So do you have any back plan? So if it goes like that, if the Minsk accords don't work at all, what we are doing, what the country is doing, what the government is doing?
Well, it's not about plan A and plan B. We have Minsk agreements. We have to stick to the whole mentality of the ceasefire. It's really difficult. It's not working ideal. It's actually far from being ideal. But if we see, if we follow the situation on the ground for the last, you know, 2 weeks, it's definitely developing and in the only way forward. If we fail, we will find the way how to defend Ukraine, how to defend our sovereignty. But the price for that would be different, and it's a key point there. But what we have to do now is really two critical things. A part of the sustainable ceasefire is closing down the border fully, and of course elections, because this is joke, a kind of fake elections Donetsk and Lugansk have been preparing now. It's not a way forward, and the way forward is to include Donetsk and Lugansk into all Ukrainian political process.
And already so far, the leaders of these so-called republics, of these armed groups, they tell that they will hold these elections. And it's very soon. It's in a couple of weeks. What if it happens? Is there any deadline? So if all goes as it is, when something would be changed?
No, it's simple. Now Russia has to deliver. Putin said quite clearly in Milan that Russia simply does not want Donetsk and Lugansk to become another Transnistria. If such elections will be held in the way that so-called presidents of Donetsk and Lugansk and parliaments of Donetsk and Lugansk will be elected, it would bring the situation exactly in the direction of a sort of frozen conflict. So now it's about clear message from Russia and from the Russian president himself not to hold elections in this way. And it's about clear message from the European Union and from everyone that any sort of reasonable and sensible assistance will be delivered only to those who are ready to enter into all Ukrainian political process.
And in general, what would be there even with this agreement to avoid a frozen conflict?
No, absolutely. The whole idea of Minsk agreements is about the mentality of the presidential peace plan, and this is the only comprehensive way forward, not because we all elaborated this plan, but because it's about a number of measures how to de-escalate the situation. It's about humanitarian dimension. It's about how to repair the infrastructure on the ground. It's about how to give the people jobs. It's about how to repair the whole economy there. But it's also about decentralization. It's also about the whole idea how to give people more freedom, but also more responsibility.
Well, I think, unfortunately, on that note, we'll have to end because we're running out of time. But thank you very much.
No, we have a couple of more questions in that way, because we are like free in this, in the Hromadske. So if there would be, we have now this news about that the German Foreign Intelligence Service and the has concluded that pro-Russian separatists were responsible for the crash of Malaysian flight. And it was, is it, what it will change? There would be this German, there was this recent.
Well, we were curious. It was, you know, the German Federal Intelligence Agency, they had in an article released, I believe it was today, there was information about MH17, that they were saying that it was the separatists using a rocket that had been fired and had brought down the flight. Is that a position that the
Ukrainians... Look, let's be honest. Is it real news in that sense? Who could be, you know, not absolutely sure that it's about them to shut down the plane as real terrorists? And for me, it was you know, a total disaster, also emotional disaster, negotiating through the trilateral contact group about real access to the crash site with them. And it's not about politics. It's about a sort of unhuman behavior there, taking borders and bringing them from the crash site. It's all about that. It's all about idea how to hide the consequences of this terrorist act. So how can, you know, it's of course a point. It's in use. But it's just a reference. But for me, I'm absolutely sure. Of course, we need a fully transparent investigation. But at the end of the day, it's not just about clear idea who is behind that. It's about bringing all perpetrators to justice. So it's exactly the goal we all have, you know, have to get in front of us.
If Ukraine relies a lot on the foreign support, but it sounds something very, very general, like support is there. If there is a one message, what do you really want from the world community, if there is a, when you're talking on that at this point?
It's not about one message. It's about real solidarity. No, I've been talking about solidarity for years, and it was not the case from the European Union, from the civilized world, and now the whole civilized world, and it's not a sort of pathetic message, it's exactly with us. And it's not just about sanctions, it's not just about political pressure, it's about making Ukraine a real success. It's about making Ukraine united, democratic, and European country.
But surely those, I mean, being democratic and united, those are things that Ukrainians do and that they do on that side. Is there one request or one concrete thing from foreign countries that Ukraine wants? Is that equipment or a certain type of financial help? Is there a key priority in the aid Ukraine needs?
You can't say we can get that, and after that we will deliver. It's about success for Ukrainian reforms. We have to deliver on reforms. But it's about a kind of assistance for self-assistance. If we get this assistance in the way how the new EU member states got this assistance for their EU membership, it will be a case for Ukrainian success. And for me, it's exactly the idea. We have a window of opportunity now. We failed on a lot of chances. We can't fail now, and it's about reforms, it's about delivering of reforms, and it's about Ukraine as a European and democratic country for me.
While there is also some criticism coming from the European partners about like not passing particular laws, for instance, on the IDPs, on the also that, you know, the Ukraine isn't fast enough to change this bureaucratic process, and that the humanitarian aid can't come to Ukraine often because the laws are not there with there are like issue with the taxes, and what you're doing to ensure that, you know, that if you want to support and solidarity, that Ukraine also does what it can do.
Look, it's a very good point. Actually, if you ask me personally, I would like to reshuffle the whole system of delivering assistance, and not only humanitarian assistance to Ukraine. We need a new system, unbureaucratic system, which gets this assistance to the point. It's already underway. And exactly after elections, and I fully believe it will come quite quickly, we will get all the necessary laws, but also, and for me it's a critical point, a real implementation, a real delivery on these laws. Because we already have a number of very good laws. Sometimes they are better than European ones. And what we need now is just start implementing them. It's, for me, it's about governance. For me, it's about anti-corruption. And for me, it's about rule of law. And on this free grounds, we could deliver on economic reforms.
But there is something which depends on you, because we have also the questions from our audience and from the diplomats that, for instance, there are no still ambassadors in such country like Germany, like the United Kingdom, where it really, really matters. And it's up to you to appoint them, but it's too long in this very, very important period when the role of the ambassador is really, really important to not to have them there.
I'm the one actually who is the most interested in appointing the ambassador, but there is also a diplomatic procedure. I will reveal a sort of secret. We spent quite considerable time in delivering the formal agreement, how it calls in the diplomatic system, for our ambassador and really a good friend of mine, Mr. Shamsher, who is now our ambassador in France. We submitted all the requests, and I very much hope that in the nearest future we could have ambassadors, and you will be pleased. I hope to see new, very pushy ambassadors in all key countries. But it's about diplomatic process, it's about getting agreements, but we will pull it off.
Last for a couple of months already. We see. So thanks a lot for your participation. We hope we can have an opportunity to ask them when they are there later on for our foreign audience. And the next time, I thought, I'm sure we would give an opportunity that you also can pose the question using our hashtags and Twitter and all the other interactive communication.
Thanks, and best wishes, actually. It's not every other day that such a project is kick-offed. So I'm really honored.
Thank you for being here with us.
Oh, we're trying to keep Ukraine interesting and explain what's happening there and show what the debates.
And part of what we touched on and what we're continuing to look at is the issue of the ceasefire, which has been imperfect, but is the framework that any progress or issue of peace has to function under in Ukraine's east. Now, what does that mean when we call it imperfect? The UN released statistics recently that 331 people had been killed in eastern Ukraine since the ceasefire was signed. So this isn't the conflict overall, but it's a sign that the violence continues, that firing from both sides is there, and that is the reality day to day. The question, or part of what we have to look at, is whether continuing the ceasefire is more costly than other alternatives, and what alternatives are actually on the table.
We would like to discuss with the journalists who are on the ground how the life, how everyday's life in this territory looks like. I'd just like to figure out that you would have a bit better understanding on the map what part of the country we're talking about. You know, for those, not everybody knows it, this is Ukraine, this is the area called Donbas and Crimea, but this, the red one, it's actually where the fighting going on. And we have heard today about the news about the more casualties and, you know, shelling in different regions, like in different places. So we have a short story from Dmitrivka. It's close to the Russian border.
Харкова, по-моему, стояли на том конце села. Ну, на другом конце села. Этих с третьего на четвертое, тех, по-моему, четвертое на пятое. Да, четвертое на пятое ночью два раза и в обед. Это уже пятое было в обед.
Много погибших?
Ну, никто туда не ходил. Так, слухи ходят, 20, 40, ну, это, наверное, много. То, что тут они, наверное, были в палатках, и, ну, как раз на них тут рухнуло, они были сонные, тут они... Ну, вообще-то, шкоду сделали больше вот это, что тут горело, это уже как боезаряд, боезаряды взрывались. Так, в основном, они точечно туда пороли. Вообще жутко было.
А потом где-то буквально через какие-то полчаса, вот, я так поворачиваю голову и, ну, допустим, если вот я стою на пригорке, смотрю прямо, да, в сторону России. Вот так вот получается Луганск. И, ну, как бы я ориентируюсь там на местности более-менее. И вот оттуда, смотрю, идут, я так поняла, град, вот, потому что залпы были, они были горячие. И это были как бы сумерки. Не помню, какое время это было.
Со стороны Луганска были залпы?
Нет, со стороны России. Вот именно. Луганск был от меня вот так вот. А вот так вот была Россия. Потом вторые залпы, смотрю, опять светится. Это буквально где-то, ну, с расстояния, может, минут 20-30. Темнело еще больше, ну, уже начали кричать «воздух». Мы начали бегать уже в бункер. Сначала как бы не совсем так реагировали, вот, но начали в бункер же бегать. Вот. И эти залпы все приближались, ближе, ближе и ближе. Вот. Ну и, соответственно, конечно... Мы не думали, что так накроет, честно, не думали. Даже последний раз третий залп был, два первых залпа, которые самые ближние были, они легли по селу под Дмитровке, потому что со стороны России получалось село Дмитровка было, а потом уже только наш базовый лагерь уже был. Вот. И оно все пошло по селу, и мы это слышали, я не знаю даже, честно говоря, до сих пор, честно, не знаю, какие там жертвы или что еще, но военные говорили, что вроде как все нормально, люди уже были готовы ко всему, поэтому они запрятались все.
Сгорело, сено сгорело, сгорел сарай с телятами, никто, ну, это деньги, за которые
Притом мы живем. Притом не то, что бомбежка, а то, что снаряды были вокруг двора, вокруг огорода. То, что у сотехника на огороде у соседа стояла. А по телевизору дивлюсь, а як рассказывают, что у нас техники нема, чтобы воевать.
У нас дня на день будут бомбить. Они не стали уезжать. Никто не стал жалеть нас. Хотя мы говорили, ребята, пожалуйста, потому что, ну...
Но они не могут уехать сами без приказа.
Начальство уехало еще до. И все это знали.
Пол КГ, наверное.
Язык не врал.
Это вы где нашли? Здесь возле дома?
Тяжело.
Грамм 300, да? Больше.
И когда вот улетели в бункер, меня мальчишки, конечно, в самый угол туда заталкивали.
People live on the ground and not just on the east, but in Ukraine you can follow on our Facebook account and Twitter account, and we subtitle, translate and provide you with the video Hromadske team is doing, and not just that, so that you can see, hope to soon our web page ready.
And after taking that look on things on the ground, we also want to take a look forward. As we mentioned before, Ukraine is having parliamentary elections on October 26th, so a week from today. We have a few polls we wanted to share with you. I think we'll get those up in a couple of moments. The issue is President Petro Poroshenko's party generally is polling in first place. The other parties that will make it in, including the Radicals and Yulia Tymoshenko's party, Batkovshina, the Fatherland Party, their position has been changing, but they're smaller. They're usually around 10%, but likely to make it in. Part of what is so striking about that is that these are generally parties that are more oriented towards the EU, towards EU integration, and are critical of Russia. It's a unique time of unified political goals in Ukraine. One that hasn't happened before and begs questions about what will happen in the future.
And the next week we'll be covering the election. It would be exactly in a week on Sunday, both in English, in Ukrainian, and probably on this time and later when there would be the results. And it's an important election because it is still the same parliament which was during the Yanukovych time. A lot of the MPs had voted for so-called dictatorship laws, so there is a little credibility in the parliament. There are a lot of new challenges with the new faces coming to the parliament. And it's a big question for the Ukrainians if the civil activists and the journalists will make it or they would be swallowed on the system. But that's we also this coverage we can provide not just during the live show, but also while following all our other medium to get into depth into that.
And that's part of it, because, again, as we said before, part of this is a conversation. And we are here to try and explain Ukrainians. You can see it's not always simple, especially with these parties and so much change that's happened over the past year. Part of what we have, though, is through a medium, we have a series of articles called Explainers, meant to make that complicated situation a little bit simpler and easier to understand. So we encourage you to take a look at those.
And now we're happy to join with another guest. We have the Professor Timothy Snyder, who is one of the best historians writing about the Eastern Europe, the author of the Bloodlands, Europe between Hitler and Stalin. And since the last year, Timothy is regularly commenting on the Ukrainian history and Russian history, the history of Eastern Europe, and also like on the historical origins of the crisis we have now.
So thank you so much for joining us today. The question that I had wanted to start off with is, in what regards the situation in Ukraine today is a special time. It seems in many ways there's more unity about questions that were very divisive in the past, concerning Europe and even concerning Russia in more negative light. We're just curious if you could put that in some perspective and what's unusual there.
I think from Ukrainian point of view, everything seems unusual. Everything seems particular. Everything seems different. When people have suffered, when people have taken risks, when they've made sacrifices, then naturally their experience seems special and personal, and that's normal and all to the good. But in a broader historical sense, what we see happening in Ukraine now is something which we've seen happen in other European states before, the emergence of a political nation with a broad consensus, with many different voices, but with a broad consensus about what belonging to that nation means and where that nation itself belongs.
So like Poland, or which countries do you find to be most analogous?
That's a wonderful question. It's actually right now, probably Poland in the 70s and 80s would be the closest comparison, where a movement emerges which resists the local government, which has a very vague idea of Europe in mind, but which nevertheless has the fundamentally sound intuition that being in Europe means something like legitimacy, dignity, and predictability. Mm-hmm.
In your recent articles and public lectures, you told that the Kremlin idea is, and that one of the goals is to, it's not that much to be, you know, deal with Ukraine, but to destroy it and destroy the European Union, to not make countries united. But when we like look at the Russian, you know, the Russian discourse, the Russian media, they usually talking about against America, against Ukraine. Why you have this argument?
Well, it's important to take the Russians seriously. To accept that they have a foreign policy doctrine, which they do, but also to accept that they're very good at confusing us about exactly what they're up to. Certainly their foreign policy is directed against Ukraine as a stable and successful state. What I think is less often noticed is that this is part of a broader policy aimed at destabilizing the European Union. Because Russia is technologically and demographically weak, the only way for Russia to become a great power is for the European Union and the transatlantic relationship to fall apart. The reason why they like to talk about the Americans is that talking about NATO, talking about the Americans, helps inside the European Union. Because then the Europeans can say, aha, the Maidan, Ukraine, that's the Americans' fault, or that's the Americans' responsibility. But I think the conflict now, since 2013, in Russian foreign policy, the main concern has not really been NATO. The main concern has been the European Union.
But what is the European Union answer on that? Do they think they understand, and the different like people in Paris, Berlin, and London have an idea about that?
Yeah, it's a terribly interesting moment because Russian elites have come to a kind of clarity about what they want in the world. They want to have a competing vision of civilization. They want the European Union to be weaker, whereas European elites are living in a world that they themselves did not make. They're living in a world that they inherited from the previous generations, and they take so much for granted, like the European Union itself. The idea that the European Union could have an enemy or that the European Union could fall apart is very difficult for people to think, and yet it does have an enemy and it could fall apart.
Well, that seems interesting because before this conflict, I mean, you're talking about how Russia saw the EU as at the very least a competitor and, you know, possibly a foe to be rivaled with. But it seems like one of the results of this conflict is that many European leaders and countries have started to see Russia in the role of a foe where they hadn't seen that before. They focus more on opportunities to work together.
Right. I'm not saying this foreign policy has a big success. I'm saying that it is coherent and we have to take it seriously. I completely agree with you. The objective outcome of Russian foreign policy has been to accelerate a trend in which Russia becomes a junior partner of China, right? Mm-hmm. If we look at the Maidan, the revolution, the counter-revolution, the war, from a global perspective, the very significant thing is that China is the winner, right? China still has good relations with Ukraine. China is in a much stronger position vis-a-vis Russia. China has much more room for maneuver in general as the Americans fall back. So China is winning, and China is trying to be very quiet about winning. And Russia is trying to be very quiet about the fact that in losing the West, it's tilting its whole population towards China. If Putin had to say, the result of my foreign policy is that we're no longer going to be like the West, we're going to be more like China, that wouldn't be very popular. So he's trying very hard not to say that, but that's what's happening.
But when you say that Russia has a thought-out foreign policy, even if it's not successful, mm-hmm. is there room in that policy and that understanding for Ukraine as it is? Is that something that can be negotiated with or not?
Mm-hmm. No. Good question. No. Okay. There is not room for Ukraine as a stable state with a European orientation. For Russia's policy towards Ukraine to change, Russia's policy towards the European Union would have to change. That's mm-hmm. what I mean when I say it's all one thing. Russian policy could change. I mean, I think it would be wise if it did. I think ultimately the future of Russia is with Europe or the West in some broad sense. That's where Russian trade goes. That's where Russian intellectual history comes from. That's where Russians like to travel. Despite, you know, contemporary disagreements, that would be the natural orientation. And they could shift back that way. All I'm saying is that they can't really change policy towards Ukraine without changing the overall policy towards Europe.
When you are on the ground, and you know, like I've been spent many time on the East, and if it was still April, you can see, you know, there are a lot of provocations, you see a lot of orchestrated conflict, and but now you feel, because of the severe, you know, the tragic situation, when there are the deaths, the number of casualties, it's more than 3,500. You have a feeling of the civil conflict, the alienation of the population, the huge distrust of the part of the population of the Kyiv government and both to those the groups which are there, the armed groups. And so what do you see? Maybe to those who sell that the solution is there. I mean, it's not about Russia, it's not about the Washington, or it's about what you do there on the ground and how people feel about the civil, you know, the way the civil conflict is there.
Mm-hmm. No, I completely agree. I mean, the reason why you have a conflict in Donetsk and Lugansk does have everything to do with Russian foreign policy. It's much easier to start conflicts than to stop them, and it's much easier to disintegrate a state than it is to create one. The only optimistic thing that one can really say, and here I echo the foreign minister's remarks, is that the horrible scale of destruction in Donetsk and Lugansk, precisely humanitarian disaster, means that decentralization is an opportunity. Not to take power in Kyiv and spread it around, because there isn't that much power in Kyiv, but to create institutions from the ground up. I think the two most important things in the Southeast are, first, to recognize on a world scale that there's an impending huge humanitarian catastrophe coming this winter, which Europe and the West will have to help with, and for the Ukrainian state to recognize that people in Lugansk and Donetsk are going to remember the last thing. Right now they think of the war, they think of their cities being shelled by the Ukrainian army, and that's totally natural to think of that. But if the Ukrainian state is able to rebuild, at least in the areas that it occupies or controls, that will be the next thing that they remember. And in that sense, decentralization and reconstruction are the only political opportunities.
So with that, thanks a lot. We'll move to the different topics. That's what very, and there was a pretty interesting perspective, which you have not always seen a lot of foreign media. And we have today the regular part of our show, which would be a very short media movement. We called it with Volodymyr Yarmolenko, who is a Ukrainian philosopher, and he'll teach at the Kyiv Mohyla Academy, and he'll shortly explain what will be in the main headlines of the main news today. And we hope. Yeah, we still. So, what we would tell that the idea of this part, and before we will be joined by the.
Is he wired?
Before we'll be joined by the our colleagues from New York Times and from the Mashable, that we will see what are the main. You know, the discourse, what are in the media. And while our guest will have the sound ready, so he would be able to talk, that's what sometimes happens technically, which you're running the show fast. We will show you the five stories which are there, and we'll see what is the most important. And I have no idea what's happening with this screen. Yeah. So, Volodymyr, what we are talking about today?
Yeah, I would like to talk about three issues. The first issue is what was happening in Milan and the Western reaction of the Western press to these events. And I like to point to two articles. One from Le Figaro, which is called "The West is Ready for a Détente with Moscow." I think it's a very important topic which should be discussed, because already in Western media we see a readiness for a sort of a compromise with Moscow, and this is something we should react in my opinion, because we should understand that the Putin is somebody who is taking 10 steps ahead and then one step back. And then basically when the Western media is discussing it seriously, that there is a time for détente, it's quite tricky to understand that. Another quite interesting article is a reaction to that, and it's an article in German newspaper, which is called Der Spiegel, and it's precisely the opposite vision, which is called hands-off sanctions. And I think it's also an important idea that basically the German media is highlighting this issue, that it's too early to talk about the lifting sanctions, it's too early to talk about lifting sanctions from Russia, because it is precisely when Russia is showing its readiness to acknowledge the Ukrainian power, Ukrainian right to take its own decisions, that we should start this discussion about the lifting sanctions.
So what is the other? Is it the old things which
we want to go?
So let's go fast. We're waiting also that our colleagues would join us.
Okay. The next piece I would like to draw your attention to is an article on the Washington Post, which is basically discussing the probable aid assistance from the West to Ukrainian economy. And it's quite an interesting thing, because we are talking sometimes too much about the assistance, the probably Ukrainian expecting assistance in military terms, but we are not talking too much about the possible assistance in economic terms. It's precisely when we're talking about precisely that the combat, that the fight is now about Ukrainian future and about Ukrainian economy, it's very important to highlight this issue that the West can also think about making more assistance in economic terms. And the idea of this article is basically that the economic assistance is not enough, is not sufficient enough. Another thing is also in the context of this debate, what the West should do, is a very interesting piece from EU Observer, from Nico Popescu, which is a blog post, basically. What he's saying is that basically the EU, the EU neighborhood policy, was a kind of a focusing too much on technical issues, on legislative harmonization, but too little on security. And it's precisely, it's very interesting thing, I think, that it's precisely in security issues where the EU can move forward and rethink its relations with Ukraine, injecting more security issues, meaning that you first build state institutions, you first build strong military, you first build strong army and strong law enforcement, and then you try, you think of, you know, harmonizing the legislation and everything else.
So I think now we can also invite our colleagues, which were always with us, because a part of the show, part of the idea of this discussion is also to invite the journalists who are working here. And we would have Noah Sneider from the New York Times and Christopher Miller from the Mashable, who'd been for a while with us, who stayed in for a while in Ukraine for the last years, and now our journalists have often the opportunity to be on the ground, and they can also reflect on that. So it's also an opportunity for them later to ask the questions from our guests. And I should also explain that Hromadske International is a project of Hromadske, which is an online media created by the Ukrainian journalist, run by the Ukrainian journalist, and independent without any businessman or politicians involved. So we be very free in our format, and we actually can start. We can see already Chris here, and Noah as well. I mean, we've met in different. So what would be your first reflections on what the foreign minister tell, and maybe Professor Snyder?
Yeah.
Have you learned something new for yourself? Is it something different what you've seen on the ground?
I think there's a bit of a disconnect between the rhetoric here in Kyiv and even the rhetoric in Milan in terms of implementation of the ceasefire and the reality on the ground, which is a fundamental disagreement about several basic issues, chiefly the border, both the border with Russia and the internal demarcation of this ceasefire line and the buffer zone. And I think that what we're seeing with the continued fighting around the airport and in places like Debaltseve is the manifestation of that disagreement, which is to say that the folks inside the separatist territories have a different idea about where that line should be.
And what is your impression on there? And, you know, like, where have been you the last time?
In Eastern Ukraine.
Yeah.
Well,
maybe you would give me a feeling, what is that? And I also would tell that we would do our best that we would provide also with a video that people could see, because it's something different when you hear.
Sure. Well, Noah and I actually, we just recently returned from Eastern Ukraine. We spent most of our time in Donetsk Oblast, but were able to also make it out to Lugansk, where things have changed rather dramatically since our last visit. We spent some time on both sides of the line, though. We were with both the Ukrainian soldiers in Debaltseve for a few days before going into Donetsk and Lugansk regions. You know, it's changed a little bit since the ceasefire, but not a whole lot. There's been a slowdown in terms of the number of shells falling, perhaps, but you know, there hasn't been any real ceasing of fire at all.
You know, when you came to Ukraine, you've stayed a lot in that area, in Donbas.
When I first came to Ukraine in 2010, I lived and worked in Artyomovsk in Donetsk Oblast, and I was working as a U.S. Peace Corps volunteer then, but
so,
I worked in the region for
so
more than 2 years.
So how different is that? And, like, you know, like, would you expect? I think nobody had ever.
It was a lot quieter then.
And besides that?
Well, besides that, you know, one of the most dramatic changes I've seen is at that time, while there was amongst my friends and colleagues, co-workers, a sense that the Donbas was different from the rest of Ukraine. You know, it had its own identity, not unlike other regions of Ukraine.
Yeah.
But they did feel a little left out from the rest of the country. But nobody there ever really expressed interest in separating from Ukraine, joining Russia. There was no real sense of separatism. Whereas now you go there and you speak to people on the ground, and that seems to be what they want, at least the people who have stayed there.
Depending on the point of the country you are, on the part of the region you are. As we know, many people had fled the area because of the threat there.
So those
the
who are still there.
From Donbass as well. For that time, the Donbass was left behind, run by the, but while the country was run by the president from Donetsk. Mm-hmm. And no, when your editors, we're interested in a bit of the way the foreign press working. So what are the stories your editors would like to get from Ukraine? Because it's always the issue, what the publishing house wants and what is happening in the country.
Right. Well, I'm actually writing mostly these days for The Economist, and one of the things that we've been working hard to do and that we're hoping to produce in the coming weeks is a real account of the state, number one, of Ukraine's economy. Everyone talks about Ukraine's economy being in crisis, and we'd like to know exactly what that means. What effects is the war having both both numerically, you know, in terms of the output in GDP and industrial production, but also in terms of people's lives?
And so far, when you know, always telling, having this opportunity at this program, you also tell, like, what would be the most interesting for you untold stories, the stories you think are least covered but should be covered?
I mean, I think the humanitarian story is always a story that should be told, that needs to be told. I believe it was Mr. Snyder earlier who was talking about the humanitarian catastrophe that will certainly come during winter. I mean, that's going to be a very, very big story. The humanitarian story is already a big story with more than 3,500 people killed in eastern Ukraine. I think it's only going to become more important as we move into winter and gas and heat become an issue.
Absolutely. And I think the other thing I'd add is a number of stories of individuals who have really made, on both sides of the line, frankly, enormous contributions, who have driven events in a way that I think is quite extraordinary, especially since we normally talk about these things in terms of geopolitics, in terms of bigger actors, but then you see, for example, volunteers on the Ukrainian side of the line who are really the lifeline for many of the soldiers out in eastern Ukraine, and similarly inside the separatist-held territories, folks who are working to provide shelter for people in areas that are being shelled.
And there would be the election next week when we will follow them. And what do you think, you know, like, is it over too much interest towards them or vice versa? You know, like in the foreign media, because it's like, oh, there would be elections, so everything will change. I mean, we have a bit different feeling about that, that, yeah, there would be elections. Okay, we're used to that.
Well, sure, it's your country's elections. I think, obviously, they're a big deal here in Ukraine. My editors are not as enthusiastic as the Ukrainian media is about parliamentary elections this year. But I think there are still interesting stories that can be told about the elections by foreign media. For example, some of the faces from Euromaidan joining the race, hoping to reform from the inside. I think that's, you know, that's an interesting story that is being told and could certainly, you know, be built on.
I think for the West, though, also these elections are seen as sort of a barometer for how much has changed inside Ukraine. So this is a way for a foreign audience to take stock of whether the ambitions of Maidan have really come to fruition. And are we seeing a change in the political structure? Are we seeing a change in terms of who's actually, who is making decisions and how decisions are being made? And I think that's what people are seeing in this election. That's why there's so much interest towards something that seems relatively normal to you.
Yeah, the question, because the most common issue when sometimes, you know, some foreign experts or somebody ask the Ukrainians is like, oh, so why things hasn't changed? You know, why right. The system hasn't changed? Mm-hmm. But what is understanding, the election is the way. It's a long time. We will follow them. And thanks a lot for coming. And for the next time, I promise we are starting with Hromadske International. We would you know, check different formats, and we would, what we would do also, we would let the foreign journalists, when we would have guests, to ask their question live and have this this discussion. And so far we mentioned the how the common people live. We had our story, how the life in the shelter in Donetsk looks like. Yeah.
Бабки сидят, которые, ну, которые не спят.
Ну и свет есть.
Ну, моя семья тут спит, не я тут.
Угу. На, я зайду, посмотри.
Вот мы едим, вот стол.
А что едите?
Ну, что приготовят люди?
А тут есть кухня какая-то? Или все на улице?
Дома. Мы дома лишь готовим.
А, то есть вы дома готовите, а сюда приносите еду и тут ее...
Да. Что успеют?
А что, часто бомбят?
Да, вот вчера град запускали, мы видели лично с глазами. И сегодня вот на телефон наш попали. Mm-hmm. Два раза.
А здесь что, у вас совсем маленький ребенок, да, живет?
Вот туда.
А сейчас он где, на улице?
Да, мама держит.
А это что такое?
Ну, тут они делают из квиллинга. Где ваша картина? Покажите, есть?
Нет, тут, давайте, не маленькую делаем, а две большие у нас есть.
Ну, это открытки?
Нет, это просто... просто мы занимаемся, картины делаем.
Ага. Они красиво делают.
В школу не ходите?
Нет. Только она ходит, а я ходит. Нет, просто не
ходит. Угу. Дальше?
Холодно, да? А у вас теплые вещи есть
какие-то? Угу, идем.
Тут люди, ну, бабушки спят.
И кот, кот тоже показывает.
Ну, это с другой комнаты. Ну, так. Там комната, и тут, а вот.
Угу.
Тут кухня на них. Ну, мне говорят, а комната вот кухня. Типа, так, как ага. Тут они чай пьют.
Прям кафе.
А. Ну, а там тоже коридор такой же идет, и все. И выход.
Ой!
Кот.
Кот. Может, телевизор работает?
Да. Ну, DVD такой.
А.
Вот так.
А туалет тут есть какой-то?
Нет, хотя бы.
А где?
Ну, ну кто тут рядом, то домой бегает, а кто это, то... Ну, сами знаете.
Не, я не знаю, ну, я никогда таких...
Uh-huh. Кто далеко живет.
И души тоже никакого, да, ничего?
Нет.
А вода есть?
Тут-то нет. Тут, ну, ни туалета, ни воды, ничего такого нет. Вон кровать и все такое.
И давно тут живешь?
Честно, ну как, не знаю, как, сколько.
Ну, месяц, два, три.
Да больше уже.
Серьезно?
Да.
Еще с весны? Ну, с конца века?
Нет.
Наверное, с июля, да, наверное, сначала, когда самое сильное началось.
Ну, вот когда, ну, не тут, а если бомбили, я в другом месте был. А когда уже тут, а то и сюда пришел. С мамой и сестрой.
А ты здесь, да, живешь?
Да.
А как тебя зовут?
Коля.
So that brings us to the end of our show for tonight. We want to encourage you to continue to be a part of the conversation using our Twitter account at Hromadske and also hashtag Hromadske to address all of these topics that are ongoing, and especially to join us next week when we will be looking at Ukraine's parliamentary election. They happen on the 26th and we will be here ready and eager to explain them.
Yeah, so that was Hromadske International in English. I hope, I know Ian, the first attempt was the first attempt. We have a free conversation from our studio in Kyiv and not just there, bringing more reports. And we will inform you what time to watch us exactly during the election night, because there would be a different schedule. So you, but be sure, following Hromadske, you would know the results, and as well, you would know what happened to the people here in the country. Yeah, see you then.
зрозуміло, що Укрзалізниця весь час, скільки вона існує, вона була корумпованим органом. Тобто, я чому знаю,
я знаю, це тендери на чай, на скатертини, да, на постільну білизну, яку там якось Денис Бігус писав, що, як там він писав, що закуповували, типу, це, щоб гладити білизну і прати в якоїсь там. Розкажіть, бо я вже не
послуги. Так. Ну, але це, тобто, тільки один такий краєчик, да, лише є і інша, ну, так би мовити, складова. Це піраміда, і, до речі, наскільки я знаю, я не знаю, не буду казати, як зараз, але раніше, я знаю, точно таке було. І на кожній залізниці, може, крім там львівської, тому що вона дуже... Це, наприклад, коли людина працює провідником, да, вона має там, ну, кожну зміну якусь суму віддавати наверх. Тобто з цієї суми трохи отримує там НЛП начальник поїзду, потім трохи отримує там начальник депо, потім трохи отримує там начальник, ну, главку, залізниці і так далі по поверху. І, ну, тобто це було завжди, і з тендерами те ж саме, ну, тобто всі останні десятиріччя.
Сейчас открываем.
Мы получаем результаты голосования, которые, ну, как зеркало отражают голосование в целом по стране.
За ЛДПР, так, потому что мне нравится Жириновский, он отказался от этого, от Мордона и все.
Громадське відбулося завдяки глядачам, але громадське й надалі потребує вашої допомоги. Громадське належить громадянам і є некомерційним проєктом. Підтримати громадське можна, перерахувавши гроші через PayPal, Privat24 або Money.ua. Ми існуємо, тому що ви нас підтримуєте. Дякуємо.
За що вони страдають?
Це солдати. Вони повинні розуміти, що воювали так завжди, так і будуть воювати. Не буває ідеальних диспозицій, ідеальних бойов, ідеальних танчиків, які не горять, там, ідеальних ракеток, які падають куди треба. Бо ми воюємо тим, що воює.
Туди.
Це не сліди від уламків, там, від осколків чи від куль. Це звичайне кров'яче гівно.
Змійте, були б нормальні, взяли б на перечати, купили б пиво, там зачіпалися з молодицями, а то приперлися якогось сюди.
Вистріл, давай.
Була яблочка.
Надежно защищена. Теперь ей не страшен. Наверное, даже прямое попадание 120-й мины.
Защищаю украинского братья, помогаю.
Єсть
по дому! Блін, це наші громадяни. Ми за них тут зараз воюємо, як це наш може не сіпати?
Ви знаєте, що у цьому їдять діжачків?
Я просинаюся, з одної сторони він лежить коло мене, з другої сторони шмонька лежить.
Мало.
Попав.
бережіть там себе і бережіть свої каски.
Дитинство моє вогонове, ви приходите в сни.
Якщо у день голосування ви будете знаходитися не за місцем реєстрації, не хвилюйтесь. Ваш голос не пропаде. Виборці мають право тимчасово змінити місце голосування без зміни виборчої адреси. Для цього зверніться з письмовою заявою до відділу ведення Державного реєстру виборців за місцем реєстрації або за місцем, де ви будете перебувати у день голосування. При поданні заяви пред'явіть паспорт громадянина України або військовий квиток та надайте документи, які підтверджують потребу в зміні місця голосування, довідку з місця роботи, наказ про відрядження тощо. Для кримчан процедуру спрощено. Працівник Держреєстру лише перевірить кримську реєстрацію виборця. Працівники відділу ведення Держреєстру допоможуть написати заяву. Заяву необхідно подати не пізніше 20 жовтня. Проте радимо звернутися до Держреєстру завчасно. Документ розглядають невідкладно, і виборець отримує посвідчення про тимчасову зміну місця голосування встановленої форми. Він включається до списку виборців на тій виборчій дільниці, на яку йому змінено місце голосування. Якщо така виборча дільниця знаходиться за межами одномандатного виборчого округу, де він зареєстрований, виборець має право на отримання виборчого бюлетеня лише в багатомандатному окрузі. Тобто проголосує лише за партію і не зможе віддати свій голос за депутата-мажоритарника.
Громадське потребує твоєї підтримки. Ми належимо громадянам України і є некомерційним проєктом. Підтримати проєкт можна, перерахувавши гроші через PayPal, Privat24 або Money.ua. Громадське існує за рахунок саме твоєї підтримки.
Не чекай, тиха смерть травневого розмаю.
непомітно догорає рай. Я тебе сьогодні покидаю, ти мене на завтра не чекай.
Смерть травневого розмаю непомітно догорає рай. Я тебе сьогодні покидаю, ти мене на завтра не чекай.
Тиха смерть травневого розмаю непомітно догорає рай. Я тебе сьогодні покидаю, ти мене на завтра не чекай. Тиха смерть травневого розмаю непомітно догорає рай. Я тебе сьогодні покидаю, ти мене на завтра не чекай. Само, що красу весняну не зберіг. Все, що наче вперше, не востаннє. Різні є дороги та світи. Посиди зі мною на прощання, назавжди ще встигнемо піти. Тиха смерть травневого розмаю непомітно догорає рай. Я тебе сьогодні покидаю, мене на завтра не чекай. Тиха смерть травневого розмаю непомітно догорає рай. Я тебе сьогодні покидаю, ти мене на завтра не чекай.
Я водій маршрутки.
Я скоро одружуся.
Я фанашахтер.
Начальник отдела продаж.
Я прораб.
Я программист.
Я свидетель на свадьбе.
Борщица.
Дядя Юра, таксист.
Я вчитель физкультуры.
Я студент-геолог.
Своя фирма.
Я кращий друг зі школи.
Я сусід, який завжди стукає по батареї.
Я єдиний син.
Якщо 26 жовтня з поважних причин ви не зможете проголосувати за місцем свого проживання, є можливість проголосувати там, де ви перебуватимете в день виборів. Для цього якнайшвидше, але не пізніше 20 жовтня включно, прийдіть до відділу Державного реєстру виборців із паспортом і підтверджуючими документами та подайте заяву. Виборці Криму можуть не надавати підтверджуючих документів. Якщо ви будете голосувати за межами свого виборчого округу, то в день виборів вам видадуть лише один бюлетень для голосування за партійними списками. Ваше майбутнє залежить від вас. Детальна інформація на сайті drv.gov.ua.
Района решили провести просто от себя в субботник, посадить на этой площади березы, рябины, приукрасить площадь.
А кто был инициатором?
Инициатором были сами мы, жители ближайших дворов.
Хочется как-то поучаствовать в изменении нашего города, который в последнее время очень много претерпевает неприятных изменений в сторону улучшения.
Мы все очень любим свой город, и мы очень хотим сохранить красивый исторический центр нашего города. И мы боремся за то, чтобы этот новострой, который строит Аднан Киван, чтобы его к крайнем случае хотя бы понизили в этажности или совсем запретили строительство этого дома на наших исторических катакомбах.
Надо
сюда
воду заливать.
Надо заливать воду и делать турбинку.
Садили деревья, чтобы помочь природе. Ну, природа, конечно, состоит большинство из деревьев и разных зверей. Но зверей мы купить не могли, зверей не появляется так момент. Но деревьям мы смогли помочь. Мы садили деревья, ну, березы, да, хорошие, красивые деревья.